You and I are paying taxes. This is public purse money. It comes with conditions. We do have to handle it responsibly. And we had some news on this, view on this one.
Yeah, Barney at Bat and Hall Blue said the amateur rugby union below the Premiership in the Championship gets almost twice as much funding as the whole of Rugby League, 23 million versus 12 million. The 12 Premiership clubs get 59 million. I know the RFL have the government loan as well, but that has to be paid back eventually. Seems to me that such disparity in funding cannot be justified by crowds at pro level or even participation. In total, Rugby Union get 123 million to Rugby League's 12, 10 times as much. It stinks. It is all loans for everyone, I think is the one thing to sort of say there. Where it'll become disgusting in a disparity will be when some of these loans get written off, and I'm pretty sure they're going to write off the bigger ones.
Potentially.
You know, because by the time the repayment... Because the repayment's got to be different, surely. You can't be expecting to repay 28 million that Rugby League will have to repay in the same time that you would be expected to repay 135 million, you wouldn't have thought. So that's where it fucking stinks for me. Because that's where, when a different government comes in because of the ineptitude that this one's shown, it might, you know, by that point, it might be too late to change the terms of this, whatever they've agreed.
There is part of it that is our own fault in some respects, in that rugby union have a much wider footprint across the country, which you can't argue with. Therefore, more people are within an hour, 90 minutes of a professional rugby union club than are within the same distance of a professional rugby league club. Therefore, they are going to serve more of the population, therefore probably going to be entitled to more money. You look at their crowd figures on internationals, for example, because the international game is so much more prominent.
Their crowd ticket prices.
And their crowd ticket prices as a result. Therefore, the revenue is much bigger. And you look at the commercial sums involved, and it does so because they prioritise, you know, international game, their international game, and that's where they make their money. They are more leaning towards the winter as well in terms of where they get their biggest crowds. So therefore, this period is going to come. Whereas, yes, we've got, you know, the grand final and our other events in that time, but we've got generally less in that period. So I can see the logic for it, and I can think there is an element to us that, you know, this is where we're talking about things like expansion, things like growing the international game. This is why we need to do it, to have more of a say at the table in this sort of thing.
Yeah, and I think there's some sense in what Rim is saying in terms of we've picked and, you know, we've asked for an amount that we can be sustainable with, to is talking in terms of repaying. So you know, we've looked at it from that point of view in an honourable, we want to repay this way, whereas no fucker at Twickenham's thinking they're going to repay 135 million in their fucking life. But yeah.
Equally, they could make that back in. They could put on what, two or three international extra games and probably make most of that back. So it's probably the same similar level of bet for them.
One thing that I think is bad for Rugby League is that now crowds can start going back in some areas from the 3rd of December or the 2nd of December, whenever it is that this latest national lockdown ends, up to 4,000 in outdoor venues, which I think is fantastic news for the country, that some people will be able to get back into sporting venues. I just think Rugby League has had to go through much more time without crowds than other sports with this, because we've played, you know, 2/3 of our season that way and had all of our marquee events in those circumstances when other sports haven't had all of their marquee events yet. I know some of them will have lost off at the start of the pandemic as well, don't get me wrong, but because I know like one or two rounds of the Six Nations had to be played at the end, didn't they, or something, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Details, the specifics, but it just seems that that's a blow for Rugby League in terms of the timing. It feels sometimes like things stack up against our sport and we don't help ourselves too, and so when the luck strikes against us like this, then
it's because we're less resilient, we've got less finances to absorb any shocks. So we can't have bigger shocks because we're on such a knife edge to start with. If we had a more expanded footprint, a more sustainable model in general as a sport, then we'd be able to do that.
But if the government locked down in September, we could have had a crowd for the grand final. Or October, or what have you.
Yeah, well...
Anyway, it isn't to be that way, and Rugby League have got the money that we say we want and that we can be sustainable with. And really, there's no true value in judging us against Rugby Union, even though it does seem like a strange disparity to an extent. Okay, let's move on to more sort of Super League pressing news. And let's talk about a news story, Tim, that broke whilst we were recording the last time together 2 weeks ago. And it's taken that long to confirm it. He just wanted to do it on Sky, didn't he? But Huddersfield Giants have appointed Ian Watson as their new head coach on a 3-year contract. We've seen coaches sacked on Sky and hired on Sky this year. 44-year-old Watson, who takes up his new role on the 1st of December, has replaced Simon Wolford, who left in September. He told the club's website, "I was attracted to the potential of the club. Everything about it screams top four. The longer-term aims have to be challenging the top teams in Super League. The footing the club has with the youth coming through, the location of the club and the owner means that it's set up to do that. My approach is about the collective. Everything is about the team, the people you work with, and having good relationships. No one achieves anything on their own, and you've got to be a collective unit." A couple of things you could challenge in that, but a couple of things in that definitely you would see underpin this move from Salford to Huddersfield.
Yeah, are Huddersfield's fans top four?
I mean, I don't know if they scream.
Yeah, well, I mean, I certainly think their musical instruments are not top four.
Yeah, I think they do have probably a more robust and long-term off-the-field setup than Salford have tended to have in recent times.
When did they last go bust category?
Yeah, and also they have a side that has got that mixture of experience and youth. It sounded to me like what Watson was looking for was a club that he could stay at his house to be at, so he didn't have to move, and a club that had a more tiered structure in their sort of system, so that he had an academy, he had a reserves, he had a first team squad, and a first team squad that was someone that was capable of spending full salary cap on that first team squad, which Ken Davey has persistently done in his support of the Huddersfield Giants. So I think that's what that coming together of those elements is what I took from this. I don't believe that everything about them screams a top four club, but I certainly think with Watson, with Davey's financial support and with the excellent youth system that they've got coming through, they can be a competitive side in the next 5 years, possibly more consistently than Salford.
Yeah, I think it's a good fit for him. And I think partly for the reasons you said about the academy and the locality, is slightly better fit for him than Hull FC would have been.
Yeah.
So I think that makes sense. Speaking of Hull FC, though, captain Danny Houghton has signed a new 2-year contract extension with the Black and Whites as he completes his 14th season in the team. Hooker Houghton, who's 32, made his debut for Hull FC against Harlequins in June 2007 and has since surpassed 350 games for his boyhood team. He was part of the 2016 and 17 Challenge Cup final winning side and was named Man of Steel in 2016. One last go for you, mate?
Yeah, it makes sense. I couldn't see him playing somewhere else, and I think they've started to acknowledge the passing of time and the need to go in a slightly different direction by using him as an interchange hooker now, so I think it's sensible.
Yeah, I think it gets the best out of him, and I think his target for those 2 years is to pass on that and that knowledge and that wisdom and to have a orderly transition out.
Yeah, it's fit enough to go on for more than 2 years, I think, as well. So I don't think this will be his last deal at the Black and Whites. Leeds Rhinos forward Bodine Thompson has signed a new 2-year deal with the Super League club. The 32-year-old New Zealander initially joined the Rhinos in August on loan from Toronto Wolfpack and spent 3 months at Henley. However, following Toronto's exit from Super League, he's now agreed to a deal to stay with the Challenge Cup winners. 2-year deal for Bodine Thompson. They've obviously really liked what they've got from him at Leeds.
Yeah, I mean, he fits in well, and when you get a prop with some experience, and he's probably coming slightly cheaper because he was desperate for a job, he's probably worth the money, I'd say.
They were light in that sort of back row area. In the pack, they were light by the time he was brought in, and also in terms of experience in the pack, they need to have some of that because they've got other people like Cuffbo moving on. This helps maintain a senior presence.
You know, James Buchanan last year as well, who's filling that sort of role. He kind of slots into that for me, so I think he's probably a decent buy at probably fairly decent money.
Mm-hmm.
Castleford teenager Bailey Hodgson is to join his uncle Josh in Australia's National Rugby League after securing a 3-year contract with the Newcastle Knights. Hodgson, who's 18, can play either fullback or centre and only made his Tibers debut in October against Hull KR. The nephew of the Canberra hooker, Josh, will begin 2 weeks of mandatory quarantine when he lands in Australia. Castleford have confirmed the undisclosed fee for Hodgson will be reinvested into the playing squad.
It feels win-win. Cass have solidified their fullback position for the next 2 to 3 years, haven't they, with the signings they've made for next year.
Yeah.
And they've got a fee for the young man, who clearly has got talent, and so he can develop as well, which might make him a more exciting prospect for the national side potentially.
Yeah, I think it's as you say, it is wins all round.
Salford Red Devils centre Dan Sargeson has signed a new 2-year contract to keep him with the Super League club until the end of 2023. The 27-year-old, 2-time Super League winner, joined the Red Devils from Wigan for the 2020 season. Born in Australia, Sargeson has won 3 England caps and made 11 appearances for Salford this term.
Did you see the classic quote of that is someone who wanted to play for the new badge? That's why they were keen to sign him.
Well, I was like, I tell you what then, if he's signed to 2023, he needs to be wary, because that's the sort of timescale where they'd change a badge at Salford.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is a really good bit of business. I think he's landed well there at Salford. He seems happy. And as I've said countless times on the pod, you know, Dan Sargeson is a cracking bloke and someone that you want in your side, because off the field, he relaxes people, and he acts like a 12-year-old, but also someone who's got a lot of knowledge and nous about the game as well. So he's someone that I want in my team all day long.
He doesn't lack for effort and enthusiasm on the pitch as well. Like you say, exuberant off the pitch, but on the pitch as well, he really rolls his sleeves up and shows leadership qualities now, I think, in that Salford side. So it makes total sense to lock him down before he gets a transfer bid coming in from Huddersfield.
Definitely. Hull KR have signed experienced Fiji international prop Corbin Sims on a 2-year contract. The 28-year-old has made more than 140 appearances in Australia's NRL for Brisbane Broncos, Newcastle Knights, and the club he joins from, St George Illawarra Dragons. And, right, of course, it's a news story, so Tom Andrews got in touch.
I'm going to start proofreading the things that I'm copying from the BBC website, because this is teaching me a lesson here, because he's not a prop, is he? He's a back rower. Anyway, Tom...
I think he has played prop, to be fair, but I would suggest he was more of a back rower.
Tom Andrews, anyway, said, looks another good signing, probably my favourite so far. If he played with the same passion his brother did at Wyatt, then we should be in for a treat. This one came out of left field for me. I was not expecting this move. I think it is potentially a good move for Hull Kingston Rovers, albeit in the wider context of it's another massive shift of squad at Hulk AR, which just doesn't make sense to me.